The following is a class on the Bhagavad Gita as it is, second chapter, text number 12, given by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded in March 1966 in New York.
This is the clear bhasma, number 12, verse of the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita. Now, I have already explained that because Sri Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and because He has got clear vision, and because He has full knowledge, He cannot give us misdirection. And what is given, that is perfect. So we have to believe that in future, even after liberation, now one thing we must also explain, the liberation, the conception of liberation. So there are different five kinds of liberation. One of them liberation is to become one with the Lord, one with the Supreme. That is called Sahajya Mukti, to merge into the existence of the Supreme. That is also another. That is one of the five liberations. That is not the only liberation. That means we all individual beings, we are individual constitutionally. God is the father or creator or whatever, or the source of our life or source of our existence, whatever you like, you can say. So we have been created in that. Eka Bahushyam, God has become many. This is also version of the Vedas, that many, all these many, we are also God. Just like the fire that diffuses its sparks. This spark coming out of the fire, they are also parts and parcel of the fire. Similarly, we are all parts and parcels of the Supreme. He wanted to become many. He wanted to become many. So He has become many, and we are that many. So we are not different from God. We are not different from God. But because He wanted to become many, so we have become many. Now thing is, when God wanted to become many, there must be some purpose behind this. Otherwise, why did He like to become many? He was one. One without second, that's all right. But why did He become many? So that is a question one must like to put. That why God became many? That answer is that because God is Satchidananda Vigraha, He is all pleasure. Therefore, without many, there is no pleasure. Just like here, I sit down the whole day alone. But I become more active and more pleasing when you come. Whenever we want to enjoy some pleasure is not enjoyed alone. Pleasure is enjoyed with many. Now, God is by nature, His anandamaya bhyaka, is always full of pleasure, full of blissness. But if He wants to become many, it is His omnipotent, He can become many. Where is the objection there? He can manifest Himself in various ways. Just now quoted a verse from Brahma Sanghita, Advaita Achyuta Anadi Anantarupam. Anantarupam means unlimited forms. Unlimited forms. Still, they are one. In spite of becoming unlimited, that one. This life. The sun, if you put here millions of pots, water pots. In every pot you will find the sun's reflection. But that millions of reflections, sun, does not mean the sun has lost his oneness. Sun is one. That is also a Vedic system, that we are a reflection like that. So anyway, many forms of God is from the desire of God. Now, out of this, because God has got some desire, transcendental desire, to enjoy with many, he enjoys with his own energy, because he is all perfect. Just like, if I want to enjoy life, I want a family, I want a wife, I want children, I want friends, I want servants. So I have to think before having a wife, you see, because I am limited. So I think twice, whether I am able to keep a wife, then whether I am able to maintain my children. These things are considerations. Actually, in the present society, every young man is thinking like that. You see, whenever the question of marrying is there, they think like that. But that thinking is due to our imperfections, because we are not all powerful. Therefore we think like that. But when we give the qualification to God that He is all powerful, omnipotent, so He can maintain any number of children or any number of wives. Otherwise there is no meaning of omnipotent. So similarly, God has become many, and He has got a plan behind the thinking of many. Now, out of these many, if one wants to merge again into the existence of God, so God has no objection. God has no objection. Now, from God we have become many. Now, suppose I or you want that I don't want to keep myself as one of the many. I want to become one with you. If you like that is called Sahajya Mukti. So God does not deny it. All right, you merge into me. But that does not mean all other many is also merged into you. That's because individually I want to merge into the existence of God. That does not mean all other many, because many means not only I myself. There are millions and billions and trillions of many. So, if out of that trillion, billion, one wants to merge into the existence of God, the God has the all-powerful, why he should deny or like to merge it? If you don't want to keep your individuality, if you want to merge into myself, all right, you are welcome. Jidathānān prabhadvante, in the Bhagavad Gita you will find it, anyone who wants me in any way, I fulfill his desire. So, that oneness, merging into the existence of God, that is not a general rule. That is a specific, in a sense only, that if anyone wants to merge into the existence of God, he can do that. God has no objection. But if others, that does not mean that everyone as a rule merge into the existence of God. No. There are others. Just like another example, you take it. Generally this example is given that the rivers all flow into the sea and they become one. Or the drop of the ocean water, when put into the ocean, the drop of the ocean water loses its existence, it becomes one with the sea. That's all right. Now, if you have seen the ocean, there are always millions and millions of drops coming out by the dashing of the waves, you see. That is going on continually. And some of them again falling into the water. They lose the drop existence. But that does not mean that the creation of drop is stopped. Even from that example, you see. And because the river water comes and merges into the sea water, that does not mean the river, all rivers have stopped. The rivers are there. But another example, now there are many aquatic animals within the water. They are also, now as the drop of the water emerges from the sea water and again merges into the sea water. So that is a nice example. But these fishes, these aquatic animals, they are also born in that water. Nobody has given these aquatic animals from anywhere else. They have taken their birth from that water. They are also born of the water. Just like the drops of the water are also born of the water. Similarly, these living aquatic animals, they are also born of the water. Now, the drop of the water merges into the water and loses its existence. That does not mean there are other living entities within the water, millions and billions, they also lose their identity. They keep their identity. So, some of the living beings may merge into the existence of the God. That's called Adhijjanurti. But there are many millions and millions and billions of Ananta. They want to keep their existence and enjoy the association of God. That is the difference between Jnani and Bhakta. The Jnani's ultimate end is Nidhed Brahmanusandha. They want to become one with the Supreme. The Jnani does not want to keep himself separately from the Supreme. He wants him to be merged.
You mean Nidhed?
Jnani means philosophers, empiric philosophers. Empiric philosophers, you see? Brahma, Brahmavadi. Those who want to merge into the existence of Brahma. They are called Jnanis. And those who meditate on God within himself, they are called yogis. This is general definition. And those who worship the Supreme as personality of Godhead, they are devotees. So, the Supreme Truth is Brahma, Paramatma and Bhagavan. The Supreme Truth. Now, because we have already explained that each and every individual being has got his individual minute quantity of independence. God has given us. Now, by our independence, I may accept as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, I may accept Him that the all-pervading super soul, and I may accept Him that the all-pervading Brahma, impersonal Brahma Jyoti, the effulgence. So, all these are applicable to the Absolute Truth. Now, it depends on my discretion whether I want to merge into the existence of the Lord, whether I want to keep my individuality and associate with Him as friend, as father and mother, as wife, just like we have got relations. So that depends on my discretion. But now, comparatively, if we study that if we merge into the existence of God, at least in the opinion of the bhaktas, that is not acceptable. That is not acceptable. They know that the God has created me as individual being. So He has got some purpose. And because He has created me for some purpose, I must fulfill that purpose. I must fulfill that purpose. Now, I can give you another crude example. From the mother, suppose a few children, a half a dozen children have come. Now, what is the intention of the mother? The mother or the father, mother and father, same thing, who has taken the responsibility of the children, they want to be happy. Otherwise, why people are taking so much trouble whole day for maintaining their children? There is some happiness. Nobody wants take so much trouble. But at home, because there is some happiness by seeing the children, while maintaining the children, but therefore he takes so much time. Now, at the same time, the children has also some troubles of life. Now, if one of the children requests the mother, "Mother, you have given birth to me, but I find my life very troublesome. Better you again put me in your belly." Is it a good proposal? It is not at all a good proposal. That is a disappointment. Oh, the mother says, "Oh, my dear son, you are in trouble, therefore you want to come again into my belly. You want to merge into my existence again." Well, the mother is unable, she cannot do that. But if such kind of request is made to the Supreme Lord, he can accept that. For him it is not possible, impossible. All right, you want to merge into my existence, come on, I take it. But the thing is, whether the son who requests the mother or the father like that, he is same person. The same son, the intelligent son, will think, "Well, my father and my mother, they have brought up me, they have begotten me, they have given us our life, all right, let us serve our parents, let them be happy, our activities, so that is the natural way. So because God has created us in so many individual living entities, we are all parts and parcels, just like father and son and mother and son, sons and are the parts of the body of the mother. We get this body from mother's body. That's a fact. Similarly, you will find in Bhagavad Gita also that this material nature is the mother and the Lord is the father. Father is giving seed into the womb of the mother, and we have all come out from it. We have got this material body. Similar thing. Now, this point that to merge into the existence of the Supreme Lord, if it is proposed by some individual soul or individual living entity, that can be accepted by the Lord. That is not very difficult. But the thing is, whether we should think like that, whether it is good for us, that is my choice. If I want to merge, you follow me, what I say, if I want to merge into the existence of God, just like if your son wants again to merge into your existence, because you are a human being, it is not possible for you. But it is not impossible for God. God can accept, all right, you want to merge them to me. All right, come on, I accept it. So that is not impossible. So that merging into the existence of God, there is a liberation like that. But that is not the ultimate. There are other individuals who may not agree with that kind of salvation or liberation. They want to keep their individuality and enjoy the Supreme Personality of Godhead's company, just like Arjuna. And in the fourth chapter, you will see that Arjuna, when Sri Krishna said to Arjuna that this system of yoga was first explained to the sun god. Now, then Arjuna inquired, how is that? You are my contemporary. How you say that you advise or instructed this yoga system to sun? That means crores and crores, millions and billions of years before. How is that? Same question. Now, in that question, the Lord answered, my dear Arjuna, yourself and myself, we took birth many times, but you have forgotten. I have not forgotten. Now here, you see, that because Arjuna has taken up that transcendental belief, that he wants to keep with the company with the Lord. So if anyone wants to keep company with the Lord, he is welcome. There are five different kinds of relation with God. Shanta, Dasya, Shakya, Vatsala, I think I gave you one there. The merging into the existence, this is called Sajujya Mukti. Sajujya. Yes, Sajujya Mukti means liberation by becoming one with the Lord. Mukti means liberation. Mukti means now we are in egoistic condition with this material body. Now mukti means when we shall be liberated from the material existence and we shall get our spiritual life proper. That is called mukti. Just like a person is suffering from disease, fever. Now when he is out of fever is attacked, he is called mukta. Roga mukta. Roga mukta means he is free from the disease. Similarly, mukti means because we are now encumbered with this material body, as soon as we become free of this material conception of life, that is called mukti. That is called Brahma-bhuta. Brahma-bhuta. Generally, Dr. Mishra is teaching this, that you, what you think of yourself, what I am, I'm not this body. That is the whole process of this teaching. So, we have already discussed, and it's the same point is being discussed nicely in Bhagavad Gita, that we are not this body. Our material identification is wrong. So we have come to that point, come to that stage, you see, that I am not this body. And because I am not this body, therefore, I have no connection with this world. Because my connection with this world is due to my body. It's due to my body. I consider one woman my wife because I have got bodily connection. I consider somebody my son because bodily connection. I consider this town, this country my country because my body has grown up from this land. So in this way, as soon as one becomes free from the conception of identification of this body, he becomes a liberated soul. Therefore, you will find in Bhagavad Gita and the later chapters that as soon as one emerges out from this conception, he is prasannātmā. Oh, I have no response to this. I have no response. And brahma-bhūta prasannātmā na sojati na kāṅkhati. As soon as he is liberated, just like a man, free from the attack of fever or any disease, when he is recovered, he finds himself happy. Oh, now my disease is now gone. I'm happy. Similarly, as soon as we come to the spiritual understanding of our existence, then our life will be joyful. That is the sign. Whether a man is freed from this material existence, mukti. Mukti can be achieved even in this life. Mukti. Mukti, it is a question of conviction. Now we are convinced fondly that I am this material body. And as soon as I gave you the other day the example of Socrates, you are convinced that I am not this body. So you have offered poison, it gladly should be. Well, what is this? I can take it. Because yes, then you hook the push. That is you liberated soul. Never mind. You want to kill me, I don't like. All that. So this is liberation. Now this liberation is divided into five. There are five consciousness. One of the liberation is to merge into the existence. Our birth was from the Supreme Absolute. Now, after liberation, we merge into the existence of the Supreme. That is called Sajidya Mukti. Now, besides the Sajidya Mukti, there are other five Muktis which the Vaishnava Sampradaya or the devotees, the Lord's devotees, they accept. They practically, those who are pure devotees, they do not want any kind of mukti. They do not, even they are offered. They are simply after the service of the Lord. They are prepared to suffer any kind of suffering. They are not affected by all those sufferings. What they want, pure devotees, they want that I must serve the Supreme Lord. That is their mission. So anyway, these bhaktas are the devotees of the Lord. For them, there are other four kinds of mukti. And what is that? This is sarujya mukti, to become one with the... Now, then sarupa mukti. Sarupa mukti means the spiritual body becomes as the features of the spiritual body becomes just like the Supreme Lord. Yes, just like Narayan has got four hands with Sankha Chakra Gada Padma and the lotus flower, corn cell, club and wheel. So everyone who takes that Sarupa Mukti just becomes just like the his feature of the body becomes just like the Lord. You see? That is called sarupam. And see, there are two explanations, sarujya and sarupa. Then salokya. Salokya. Salokya means one can get habitation, residence in the same planet where God is there. That is salokya. Shasti. Shasti means to get the same opulence. As I already explained, opulence. He gets all the opulences as the Lord has got. He becomes so as good as Lord, becomes so powerful. You see, this is called Shasti. And the last is Samipya. Shamitva means he is always in the company of the Lord, just like Arjuna. Arjuna is always, whenever Lord takes his incarnation, Arjuna is there. Arjuna is there. Shamitva. Is there never separation. Just like a husband and wife, never separated. You see, or the father and the son. Of course, nowadays the question is different. But generally, the family members, they all remain together. Samipa. And the father and the boys and the wife, they remain together. Samipa Mukti. Samipa Mukti means to remain always as associates of the Lord. That is Samipa Mukti. So these five kinds of muktis are there. The purpose is that even after liberation, living entities, they keep their individuality. Just like an associate of the Lord, as resident of the Lord's planet, or to have the bodily features of the Lord in so many ways. And one can merge into the existence of the Lord. That is also accepted. So simply merging into the existence of God, That is not the only liberation. That is one of the liberations. But the devotees of the Lord, they do not accept that kind of. They do not want to merge. They want to enjoy the company. That is the difference between them. Both of them have become liberated. Merging into the existence of God, that is also liberation. And to keep individuality and enjoy the company of the Lord, that is also liberation. Demigods, they are just like delegated officers for maintaining this material existence. Just like sun. Sun is a demigod. Sun, the moon. Moon is a demigod. Take for example, the sun, the chief living entity, or the chief man, or chief living being in the sun planet. Now, his position and my position, there is a vast difference. And he is maintaining such a planet, and he is situated there as the chief man or the chief living being. So his degree of power is far, far greater than the degree of power he has a President Johnson or something else, you see. So that degree of power does not make him that he is God. He is not God. He is also servant of God. Anyone, even Brahma, anyone. There is a verse in Chaitanya Charitamrita, Ekola, Ishar, Krishna, Harsha, Vritta. The individual living entities, there are so many, multi. But all of them, they are servant of the Lord. There may be, their position may be upper and lower in different degrees, but that does not make them equal with the Lord. The Lord is different. That is also mentioned in the Patanjali Yoga system. Lord is supreme. He is the great. He is the greatest. Asamodha. Nobody is equal with him, and nobody is greater than him. That means nobody is equal with him, nobody is greater than him, that everybody is lower than him. Demigods, just like you and me, that they have got a degree of power than me and him. There is a control, just like here in this planet, when you go and up, you see it is a ball. But in this ball, there are so many controlling deities here also. President Johnson, Prime Minister of India, this and that and so many things. But when you go up, you see just like a ball. You see? So when you come here, you find similarly from the distance of 90 millions of miles, you can see and this sun just like a ball. But it is not ball. It is far, far greater than this planet. And there are cities, and there are men, and there are persons, and everything. But they are made up of fire. Their body is made of fire. Your body is made of earth. That is the difference. Just like in the water, you cannot live, because your body is made differently that you cannot live in the water. Similarly, the aquatics in the water, they cannot live in the land. Similarly, because I cannot live in the sun planet due to this my body, that does not mean there are no living beings. They are living beings. You see, after all, the whole material world is made of five elements. Earth, water, fire, air, and ether. Now, these five elements, in some planets, you will find earth predominant. In some planets, you will find water predominant. In some planets, you will find fire predominant. In some planets, you will find air predominant. But that does not mean that there are no living entities. There are living entities. The sun planet is a planet where fire is predominant. Now, according to medical science, that by heat and fire, the germs are killed. But In the fire also, they are living entities. Just like Dr. Mishra was giving the example the other day about opium. So opium is a dead person. Dead person. But in the opium also, you will find some worms.
Some what?
Worms.
Worms?
Yes. How is this possible? They are also living entities. If I take a drop of opium, I die. But they are living and they are eating and living there. So because it is impossible for me to eat opium and live, but you cannot say that there are other living, there cannot be no living entities there. Similarly, you have experienced that you cannot live in the fire. That does not mean that in the sun planet there is no living entity. There are living entities. Because in Bhagavad Gita I find that living soul as it is not burnt by fire. It is not burnt by fire because it is spiritual. The material element has no power to destroy it. It is not burnt by fire. So in every planet, it is concluded that every planet, they are a living entity. They are intelligent beings. And because in the higher planet, there are more intelligent persons, beings, they are called demigods. The demigods means they have got practically and qualifications almost equal to the Supreme Lord. They have got such qualifications. Devas, that is a Sanskrit word, and real Deva means the Supreme Lord. And when you call Devas, that these Devas, they are all obedient, servants of the Lord. They are very powerful. So when you become obedient devotees of the Lord, we can get such posts in the sun planet, in the moon planet, in the heaven planet, in the Brahma planet. So the devotees of the Lord, they are not losers. They get more power for controlling power. Yeah, therefore they are called devas. Devas means those who are the... there are two words used in Sanskrit. Devas and asuras. Asuras. Now, the definition of these devas and asuras are like this. Vishnu bhakto bhavet deva asurastad viparja. Asurastad viparja. Vishnu bhakto, those who are devotees of the Lord, they are devas. This is the difference between devas. Devas and asuras, let us mean that asura has got a very ugly face. No, even a very beautiful man, he can be an asura. He can be and even a very ugly man, he can be deva. Just like Hanuman. Hanuman was a beast. He was not even man. He was animal. He comes from the monkey species of life. But he is a great devotee of Lord Ramchandra. So he is deva. So Vishnu bhakto bhavet deva. Those who are unallied devotees of the Lord, they are called devas. And those who are against the obedience of the Lord, they are called asuras. Anyone. It does not mean human being or anyone. But in the higher planet, you will find all the inhabitants there that are called great devotees of the Lord. Therefore, they are called devas, demigods. And therefore, they have been entrusted with the management of this material world. Just like confidential persons are given responsible posts in government. Similarly, because they are devotees of the Lord, they have been awarded this post to be sun god, to be moon god, to be Indra, heavenly god, to be Brahma, like that, so many, Marichi, and so many. So why do you think that only here in this planet everything is there and there is nothing? This is our foolishness. Just like you have never been to India. But I am giving an example. If you think that the Indians, they do not eat, they do not sleep, they do not marry, that is your madness. That is your madness. If you think that Indians do not eat,
yes.
or Indians, because you have not seen them, but if as soon as you know, they are also human beings like us. Just like, as for my example, when I was in India, I was thinking of America, something wonderful. Now, I see here, there is not at all any difference. The only difference is that you people have a fair complexion, your bodies are white, and they are coarse. They are not so white, but there are white men also. In India you will find varieties of caste, beginning from this American European color down to the black Negro color. You will find in India. There are so many colors. So, and actually I give you my frank admission that when I was in India, I was thinking the Americans may be a different type of people, or they may be thinking in other ways, they may be so many different things. But here I see there is no difference at all. No difference at all. Only some bodily features. Even I study the pigeons, I see, the same pigeons are here, playing just like Indian pigeons, and when I see the sparrow. So there is no difference, they are bigger. And that is also natural, you see, just like in African people, they are taller. They are taller than the Indian people. Even in, you say, your these black Negroes, they are taller than in American people. So there is little difference, of course, that is. But on the primary facie, there is no difference. Similarly, in the sun planet, in the moon planet, there are also human beings like that. And they are called devas because they are highly intellectual. They are all very powerful than ourselves. And they have got different bodies and different power and everything. Otherwise, there is no question. Even great scientists like Dr. Meghnath Shah in India, he said that there is no reason to disbelieve that in other planets there is no life. How can it? Just like because you have not seen India, you cannot say, there is no living being. It is vacant. So these people are going to the moon planet and they are saying it is full of dust, it is full of clay or something like that. All these foolishness, you see. That means they are not real. Outside they take some photos and they come out. Let them talk all nonsense. But we have got information that this moon planet is a very nice planet, you see. And the inhabitants there, they are very intelligent. The people who perform past work here in this planet, they are promoted to the moon planet. And it is very cold also. Just like here, European countries and American countries, because due to, you have come from America, European countries, people are accustomed to drink because due to the cold climate. Indians are not accustomed. Your drinking is a necessary thing in Europe. Similarly, this moon planet is so cold that they live by drinking somaras. There is a kind of liquor which is called somaras. Yes, somaras. Somaras. Somaras, here it is described in Ayurveda that somaras preparation is there. If anyone can prepare the somaras and if anyone can drink the somaras, he becomes immortal. But that means his duration of life increases. So anyway, these descriptions are there. So there are intelligent living beings there also. Body may be different, just like your body is different from me.
Yes, but with the
hand. That does not mean because you have got a different body, therefore you are not a living being. Or because I have got a different body from you, I am not a living being. So body, because a living soul is not the body. He might have different body. That doesn't matter. Why should we consider, identify with the body? The whole question is there. The body, you will find Your body is different from animal body, animal is different from human body. Father, so many differences of body. But the four principles of bodily wants, ahar means requiring some food stuff, and nidra, sleeping, and fearing, and mating. These four principles you will find even in the birds, in the animals, in the human being, or even the devatas or gods, or everywhere you will find these four principles. The only difference between the animal and the higher developed consciousness living being is that they are God conscious. They accept the Supreme Law. That makes the difference between lower animals and us. I think we should stop here.